Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am Lieutenant Commander George Gougoulidis, and for the next 20 minutes, we will discuss the impact of antifouling coatings in the energy efficiency market. Marine biofouling is a biological process that takes place regardless of geographical location or climatic conditions. Any submerged structure accumulates marine species that have the tendency to attach permanently, grow, and multiply. Marine biofoulers are divided into two main categories based on the size of the fully grown specimen, that is, microfoulers and macrofoulers. The type, coverage, and intensity of biofouling depend upon several parameters. Some of these parameters are the salinity, temperature, pollution, light, water depth, and of course the activity of the vessel. Biofouling has a major economical impact on the marine sector. The presence of fouling increases the frictional resistance of the vessel by increasing hull roughness and wall shear stress. Fouling accumulation also increases the weight of the vessel. As a result, the propulsive power to move the ship at the same speed increases. Furthermore, the increase in fuel consumption leads to an increase in the greenhouse gases emissions. Finally, fouling attached to the hull can be the source for the translocation of invasive aquatic species. To better understand the impact of fouling, we can look at the table which presents the increase in fuel consumption for different naval vessels 6 months after hull cleaning. The numbers show that in order to maintain the same speed, the increase of fuel consumption can reach up to 50%. The US Navy came up with similar results in a case study with its FFG7 frigates. More specifically, two scenarios were examined: a low speed of 50 knots and a high speed of 30 knots. As we can see, the increase in resistance due to fouling is higher at lower speeds and can be increased as high as 80%. A second case study, including the DDG-51 destroyers, yielded the same results. The increase in power, in this case, can be as high as 76% at the speed of 50 knots. To better understand the numbers quoted in the previous slides, let's translate the findings into cost. The US Navy studied 320 DDG-51 inspection reports and found that the resistance penalty due to hull fouling amounted to $56 million per year. Needless to say that the hull is not the only source of energy loss due to fouling. Actually, whenever deterioration in the performance of a vessel is noted, the first item to be inspected should be the propeller. Similarly, fouling has an impact in the performance of the machinery systems. So the question that arises is, how can we prevent fouling? The answer is antifouling coatings. There are two main categories of antifouling coatings: those which contain biocides and the ones that do not. Obviously, there are subcategories, as it is depicted in the picture, which will be analyzed in the following slides. This is a quick overview of the various abbreviations that will be mentioned in the following slides. Biocidal antifouling coatings are largely formulated in two ways: insoluble matrix and soluble matrix. The insoluble and soluble matrix paints contain biocides such as copper entrained within the paint. The insoluble matrix coatings are not popular, and for this reason they will not be analyzed. Before moving to the description of each coating, we will briefly discuss the release kinetics of the three main categories of antifouling paints. In the first case, the thickness of the contact leaching coatings remains constant. As more and more biocide is leached out, a thick depleted layer develops at the surface. Control depletion polymer paints use rosin, which allows the seawater to penetrate the paint film and to lead to the release of biocides by a diffusion process. The result is an exponential leaching rate with an excessive release in the beginning, which falls quite rapidly to a level which is too low to prevent fouling. In self-polishing coatings, the initial leaching rate is much lower than that of the CDPs, and then a pretty constant rate is achieved as a steady polishing period is established. Let's examine now each category separately. Control depletion polymer coatings contain biocides, which are integrated into a water-soluble rosin binder. The slow dissolution of rosin to enable biocides to leach is performed by the process of hydration. Additionally, an insoluble reinforcing polymer is added to the matrix to enhance its mechanical properties and control the dissolution rate. CDP coatings have certain deficiencies. Firstly, they are less effective than the other biocidal coatings, and for this reason, they are suitable for use in areas with low fouling activity or for shorter dry docking intervals. Their typical effective life is 3 years. The rosin is brittle and can lead to coating failures, such as cracking and detachment. Leach layers can become thick, leading to a gradual slowing down of the rosin dissolution. Surface roughness also increases progressively due to inefficient polishing action. In order to mimic the chemistry of the band TBT coatings in seawater, a series of acrylic polymers have been developed. The three main types are copper, silyl, and zinc acrylates. These copolymers react with the seawater, producing a soluble micro layer at the paint surface, resulting in the gradual polishing of the coating. Hydrolysis and self-smoothing produce a leaching layer of very low thickness. The result is a smoothly coated hull surface throughout the lifetime of the coating. SPC coatings display a steady antifouling performance until the total paint film has been polished away. Cleaning and recoating of SPC coatings during dry dockings is easier than the other biocidal coatings. Hybrid antifouling coatings combine the properties of both CDPs and SPCs. Their biocide releasing mechanism is a mixture of hydrolysis and hydration by mixing SPC acrylic polymers with a certain amount of rosin. Hybrids offer an intermediate performance, with their performance being between CDP and SPC coatings. Foul release coatings are a relatively new product which is mainly based on silicon technology. These coatings work by creating a smooth, non-stick surface on the hull, so fouling organisms cannot attach or remain adhered to the surface. Their low surface energy results in reduced attachment strength, so any accumulated fouling will detach while the vessel is underway due to shear stresses. Apart from the advantages of foul release coatings, there are some issues related to the respective technology. Detachment of biofouling requires a certain speed to be achieved. Otherwise, hydrodynamic forces are insufficient to completely remove fouling. Detachment of fouling takes place at ship speeds of around 8 to 10 knots. Finally, most foul release coatings display low mechanical strength and can be easily damaged by abrasion. Foul release coatings, although more expensive than their biocidal counterparts, they start becoming popular both on commercial and naval vessels. Their application is not limited to the hull, and there are cases where they have been applied to propellers. Major navies, such as the Royal Navy, have applied foul release coatings to a large number of ships with encouraging results. Another alternative to the biocidal coatings are the hard inner coatings. These coatings are offered in the market as high-performance, abrasion-resistant, anti-corrosive coatings. Their potential antifouling ability lies predominantly in their superior mechanical strength, which allows them to be cleaned at will without being damaged. What is more important to the description of the various antifouling coatings presented earlier is their comparative performance. Clearly, the more expensive foul release coatings exhibit higher performance compared to their biocidal counterparts. More specifically, in a container liner example, the low-performance CDP coatings result in a power increase of approximately 6% after a period of 36 months, while the more expensive foul release coatings result in an increase of around 1% at the same time. Similar results occur when examining the flat bottom of the ship instead of the sides. Having discussed about the current available options in the market, it is time to examine what is the future in the industry of antifouling coatings. Presently, there are indications that copper-based paints will become under regulatory scrutiny. For this reason, research is focusing on alternative natural biocides or coatings that contain no biocides at all. The current research into antifouling coatings is divided into two major areas. The first area is the modification of the surface physical and chemical properties to deter permanent attachment of fouling organisms. And the second area is the incorporation of biologically derived or inspired components. The first category includes polymer brushes, salt gel coatings, and amphifouling surfaces, among others. The second category refers to biomimetic strategies, including coatings with bio-inspired surface microtopography and coatings based on natural products such as various enzymes. Combination of technologies is also feasible. Finally, another ecological alternative is the use of fiber coatings. Some of the difficulties faced by researchers are the identification of a naturally produced material that offers a broad spectrum protection and adequate lifespan, as well as the successful integration into a coating. Moreover, the challenge for the coating industry is to produce natural antifouling compounds in sufficient quantities and at a reasonable cost, while meeting the requirements of the various environmental regulation agencies. Let's move now to some examples of these novel products. An example of a fiber coating is the product depicted here. It consists of a self-adhesive foil with coating of polyamide microfibers. The fibers create a physical barrier on the foil by forming a textured surface. The prickliness and swaying of the microfibers make the surface unattractive for the marine organisms. Tuna fish can swim at speeds of over 100 kilometers per hour thanks to a special mucus over their skin. Recently, coatings that mimic the tuna's mechanism have been developed. They work by trapping the water on the surface of the ship, thus lowering hull friction. Another example of bio-inspired coatings is the compliant coatings. Compliant coatings are capable of extending the laminar flow over a body, thus reducing the skin friction drag. This mechanism was first observed on dolphins. Gray, who studied the locomotion of dolphins, set forth his paradox back in 1936. Although Gray's paradox was based on a number of assumptions, his findings were used for the development of compliant coatings. Recent research carried out by UCLA proved that a rough surface with super hydrophobicity properties exhibits less drag in turbulent than laminar flow. For the purpose of the experiment, the surface was covered with small ridges aligned in the direction of flow. The Hellenic Navy is a mid-sized naval force that operates a relatively large fleet of over 100 ships of different sizes, types, and speed profiles. The major area of operations is the Mediterranean Sea, with the most of the Navy's activities taking place in the Aegean and the Ionian Seas, waters that can be considered as coastal. Currently, the Hellenic Navy relies exclusively on biocidal coatings. However, foul-release coatings were experimentally applied in the past on two fast patrol missile boats. Although the project was considered successful, since the foul-release coating provided satisfactory protection for a period of 12 years, no further action was undertaken by the Navy concerning the adoption of foul-release coatings. Concerning the coating of propellers, the Hellenic Navy does not follow an official policy. In practice, the propellers of slow vessels are coated during dry dockings with antifouling coatings along with the rest of the hull. Whereas the propellers of high-speed vessels are only cleaned and polished. The Navy recently applied full-scale underwater hull cleanings systematically. Underwater hull and propeller inspection is performed by the diving crews of the ships and the naval bases, while underwater cleaning is performed by the diving crews of the naval bases as well as private providers. The findings of the inspections performed underwater and during dry dockings are recorded by the quality control departments of the naval bases, and decisions are made accordingly. The conditions of the hulls and propellers, fouling and corrosion, are monitored together with other statistical information. Concluding about the positioning of the technologies presented in the energy efficiency market, it is interesting to look at the study carried out by UCL. During the study, 130 ship owners, operators and charterers were surveyed. The results showed that 86% of these companies adopted an energy efficient technology in the last 5 years. Out of these technologies, hull coatings represent 70%, making them by far the most widely adopted measure. The UCL study shows that the maritime industry prefers easy to apply and well-proven technological solutions. For ship owners, modern antifouling paints represent a low-risk solution. This explains the intense range among paint companies, which try to gain a competitive advantage by offering state-of-the-art products. At this point, I would like to thank you for your attention, and we have another 10 minutes for questions.
Κατάλαβα πάρα πολύ καλά.
Κάνω μια ερώτηση.
Παρακαλώ.
Είναι εναλλακτική λύση για το Impress Current Antifouling System και πώς εφαρμόζονται, είναι βιομηχανικά ή...
Μιλάμε για τα τελευταία προϊόντα τα οποία έδειξα. Ναι. Κάποια από αυτά είναι υπό ανάπτυξη και κάποια από αυτά προσφέρονται ήδη στην αγορά.
Εφαρμόζονται επιτόπου δηλαδή ή εργοστασιακά.
Τι είναι ούτε εργοστασιακά επί τόπου.
Με...
Κανονικά με την τυπική διαδικασία που εφαρμόζονται όλα τα χρώματα. Δηλαδή σε ένα δεξαμενισμό, καθαρισμός της γάστρας και μετά εφαρμογή. Φυσικά κάθε χρώμα έχει τις δικές του έτσι, τεχνικές, αλλά λίγο πολύ με την τυπική διαδικασία ας πούμε βαφής ενός πλοίου. Τώρα από εκεί πέρα μπορεί να είναι άλλες πιέσεις, άλλα ακροφύσια. Καταλάβατε. Αλλά κυρίως με σπρέι τα περισσότερα από αυτά.
Θεωρείται εναλλακτική λύση από τα.
Πιο φτηνή δεν είναι. Πολλά από αυτά επειδή είναι ακόμα στο στάδιο της ανάπτυξης, όπως καταλαβαίνετε, χρειάζονται πόρους για να εξελιχθούν σε κάτι το οποίο θα είναι μαζικής παραγωγής, έτσι ώστε να πέσει και το κόστος. Ευχαριστώ για την ερώτηση.
Άλλη ερώτηση έχουμε. Παρακαλώ.
Παρακαλώ. Δεν νομίζω. Από ό,τι βλέπω εδώ γίνεται, δεν νομίζω.
Τα τελευταία χρόνια, όπως είπες, και εσείς χρησιμοποιούμε το πάντα εγώ δεν πείτε ότι καταλήξουμε τη γάστρα κάτω από το νερό παιδί. Πιστεύετε ότι αυτό είναι μια από τα βασική μέθοδος για να αυξήσουμε την ταχύτητα του πλοίου ή μπορεί να αποκαλέσει σε χειρότερα αποτελέσματα σε όλο το μέλλον. Εννοώ, εάν δεν ακολουθήσει άμεσο διχαμηνισμό, δηλαδή μήπω καταστρέφει το χρόνο.
Μήπω καταστρέφει το χρόνο. Αυτή ήταν η ερώτηση, δηλαδή.
Και πάλι εδώ πέρα εξαρτάται από τον τύπο του χρώματος τον οποίο χρησιμοποιούμε. Γενικότερα έχει αποδειχθεί ότι ένας συχνός καθαρισμός και όχι σε βάθος, και το ίδιο ισχύει και για την προπέλα, δηλαδή πολλοί λένε polished not buffed, είναι το πιο σημαντικό από όλα. Δηλαδή, ανατρίμηνο, για παράδειγμα, καθαρισμός όχι εις βάθος έτσι ώστε να βλάψει το χρώμα, αλλά αυτό έχει σαν αποτέλεσμα του να διατηρηθεί η ταχύτητα του πλοίου υψηλά και η κατανάλωση χαμηλά. Φυσικά υπάρχουν και κατηγορίες χρωμάτων όπως είναι τα χρώματα που είπαμε inner T, αίσθηση τα λένε επίσης και surface treatment coatings. Χρώματα τα οποία μπορεί να μην έχουν παράγοντες βιοκτόνους επάνω, αλλά αυτά επειδή τα εφαρμόζει σε ένα ή δύο στρώματα υψηλού πάχους, γύρω στα 1000 και πάνω από 1000 DFT, για όσους γνωρίζουν από χρώματα. Και αυτά τα τρίβεις at will, όπως λέει, δηλαδή όποτε θες, όσο θες. Και το πλεονέκτημα που έχουν επίσης είναι ότι γυαλίζουν κιόλας αυτά μετά. Όσο τα τρίβεις, τόσο γυαλίζουν. Σε χρώματα όπως είναι τα CDB που είπαμε, η απλή κατηγορία που σε μεγάλο βαθμό αυτά εφαρμόζουμε, αυτά επειδή αφήνουν αυτό που λέμε το depleted layer, δηλαδή μένει κομμάτι ρητίνης, αυτά τρίβοντάς τα όντως μπορούν να αυξήσουμε την τραχύτητα της επιφανείας.
Άλλη ερώτηση. Ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ.
Θέλετε να ελευθερολογήσετε. Παρακαλώ, ναι, βεβαίως. Ευχαρίστως.
Είδαμε τέσσερα διαφορετικά είδη χρωμάτων, τα οποία από κατάλαβα ήταν προφανές ότι η αποτελεσματικότητα είναι ανάλογη με το κόστος αγοράς.
Σαφέστατα.
Υπάρχει, έχει γίνει κάποια μελέτη, κάποια διαφορετικό αρχικό να μπορούμε να πάμε σε πιο ακριβά χρώματα σε σχέση με το αποτέλεσμα αυτά σε βάθος χρόνου.
Λοιπόν, θα σας πάω στην εικόνα που έχω εδώ πέρα. Αυτή την έχω πάρει στην Κρήτη, είναι από μία πυραβλάκα του. Αυτή είναι βαμμένη με σιλικονούχα, foul release. Αυτή είναι η κατάστασή τους, όπως βλέπετε, πριν καθαριστεί η γάστρα, είναι με το που έχει ανέβει στη δεξαμενή. Και κατά το παρελθόν είχαμε αλλάξει ένα κομμάτι στην πλώρη, είχε γίνει κάποια αλασματουργική εργασία εδώ στην πλώρη, γι' αυτό το κομμάτι έχει αλλαχθεί. Και αυτό έχει βαφεί με CDP coating μπροστά. Βλέπετε τη διαφορά. Προφανώς είναι ό,τι πληρώσεις παίρνεις.
Σε βάθος χρόνου είναι καλύτερο να πάμε σε πιο ακριβά αυτό, δηλαδή το πόσο θα πρέπει να πει να καλύτερα, δηλαδή.
Σχετικές μελέτες έχουν γίνει, ήμουν ένας από αυτούς. Έγινε σχετική μελέτη που αφορά την αναθεώρηση της πολιτικής φαλοχρωματισμών του 2013, αν θυμάμαι καλά. Και η προδιαγραφή μας πλέον λέει για 5 έτη, το οποίο σημαίνει έσπιση. Παρόλο που σε κάποιο χρησιμοποιούμε CDP. Ευχαριστώ και εγώ.
Άλλες ερωτήσεις. Σας ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ.
Σας ευχαριστώ και εγώ.